And tonight we are live at Gig Lane. What next for Bury? Can the club survive expulsion from the Football League?
Didn't sleep last night. It's almost like a member of the family's died. It really is, because that's what this club is, it's family. It's just horrible.
Also tonight, some good news from down the road as breaking news comes in that Bolton Wanderers have been saved.
And I'm Stuart Flinders, also in tonight's programme. Demonstrations across the region as Boris Johnson raises the stakes in the Brexit battle. Liverpool could be one of the first cities in the country to introduce drug testing for taxi drivers.
This is a joy-free song. Why?
And sounding off, the complaints choir turning moans into music.
Good evening and welcome to Gig Lane, the home of Bury Football Club. Well, as you can see, fans have been turning up today. They've been turning up all day, in fact, despite the rain. Many shell-shocked, many in tears. In fact, the feeling here is very much of people coming to pay their last respects to a lost loved one, a wake, if you like. In fact, somebody said to me, it's no exaggeration, that they feel like the very heart has been ripped out of this town. And the reason for that, of course, that news that came in just after 11 o'clock last night, that the EFL was expelling this historic club from the Football League after 125 years. Well, tonight we will be speaking to the English Football League about their decision. We will be speaking to Bury Football Club's captain, Neil Dans, and we'll be asking whether this club does have a future. But first of all, Richard Ascombe has spent the day here and he's been speaking to the all-important fans.
Morning.
Maya. At Gig Lane today, there was anger, shock, and disbelief.
This is the end of something.
End of an era.
End of a dream.
Something's ripped from you.
Didn't sleep last night. It's almost like a member of the family's died. It really is, because that's what this club is. It's family.
Gutted. Just drained, basically. Not slept. It's horrible. The inevitable's happened, and that's the end of Bury FC as we know it.
The thought that their 134-year-old club could fold was too hard to take in.
It's hard to put into words. The overriding emotion is obviously sadness, but I'm just hoping that something good can come out in some shape or form.
Bury supporters had pinned their hopes on a takeover. Those hopes were dashed yesterday when it collapsed due to what were described as insurmountable financial problems.
The financial structures that were put in place were something that I'd never seen before and certainly were unsustainable.
The sense of loss is raw for everyone associated with Bury, including the famous Neville family, who've had a long and close connection with the club.
My granddad worked on the car park for 40 years. My nana helped in prepare the buffets for the directors at half-time. My mum's give heart and soul to that football club. My dad ultimately, it nearly killed him at one point. So the emotional tie for me and my family is that it's ripped the heart out of our town, our club.
And many Bury fans say that serious questions remain unanswered.
Could the EFL have given us a little bit more time? I think maybe, yeah. If the rumours are true and the offer was on the table and they were saying, look, we can get the money to you today, then why not give us that few extra hours?
It means a lot to these people, even if they're not Bury fans. It's a football club. That's what it is, club, not team, club. You know, it doesn't matter what team do on the pitch. You come here, you see your friends. It's escaping every Saturday to something different, and to lose that is... people don't know how to replace that.
As it stands, Steve Dale remains the club's owner, but with Bury still millions of pounds in debt and now out of the Football League, the prospect of the club folding altogether is painfully real.
Well, Richard's with me now. And Richard, as I said, mentioned before, there has been an update on Bolton, and we believe that Bolton have been saved.
They have. So much bad news here at Bury, but you're right, Annabelle. Great news for Bolton Wanderers. Their survival has been secured with the takeover from Football Ventures, this protracted takeover. We did think it had collapsed, didn't we, on Saturday. We then heard that talks were ongoing. There were more positive noises coming from the club and from the administrator as well, and that takeover has been completed. So the survival of Bolton Wanderers has been secured. There's been a quote as well, or a couple of quotes from the joint administrator, Paul Appleton. He said this, which I think is quite revealing about how he feels about the new owners. Now there can be a fresh start with owners who I believe will run the club for the good of the supporters and the community as a whole. So great news for Bolton Wanderers.
Yeah, so real relief for Bolton. Obviously, a lot of sadness here, but a lot of people have been saying to me today that they were really hoping that Bolton would survive. There's a lot of camaraderie, isn't there, between the two clubs?
There absolutely is. Yeah. I said to a supporter a moment ago, you know, it won't help you, but they said they're absolutely delighted that Bolton is safe.
Absolutely. So, I mean, real highs and lows for two of our clubs. Peter Marshall has today been speaking to Debbie Jevons from the English Football League about that decision to expel Bury, and she actually told him it was one of the hardest decisions of her career.
Gutted for them, to be perfectly honest. When you see and you understand how much a football club means to individuals, the impact on the community, and therefore I wouldn't want anybody to think that this was a decision that was taken lightly. It absolutely wasn't, and the past weeks and months have been focused on nothing else but Bury and Bolton.
Do you think that the Football League has to take some of the blame here? Do you think there have been failings on your behalf?
I think what we have to do is to, as I've said consistently, is look at ourselves, look at what happened here, and whether or not there are lessons learned from it. But it, as I say, we have done everything that we can in the rules as they currently are without question.
Do you fully understand the impact that losing their football club has on supporters groups and fans?
I understand it. I saw it. I watched on television yesterday. I hate to see that the people in tears and the impact that it has clearly had. So of course I understand, and as I said, that was one of the hardest, if not the hardest day in my career yesterday.
Can you give any guarantees or hope to Bolton fans that their club isn't going to go the same way as Bury?
I can say that as of 3 o'clock this morning, there were emails going back and forth, and then again first thing this morning. That is down to the dotting in the I's of the crossing of the T's, and I know Bolton fans have heard that before, so when I say it's close, it is, but I publicly stated that I urge all parties to get together. But I think the fact that the administrator has announced that he has taken back what he said about putting the club into liquidation, he's now said that isn't imminent, I think we can take that as a good sign.
Debbie Jevons there speaking to Peter Marshall, and whatever the EFL's reasons for expelling this club, it won't bring any comfort to the fans here today. They have lost their club. People are out of work, including the players, which we must also think about today. And earlier I was speaking to the captain, Neil Dance, who told me how he felt when he heard the news.
Devastated and still in shock at the moment. At the moment, it just, none of it feels real. And just being close to gig now and seeing it, I still can't believe it.
Do you find it shocking that a club in this day and age, and you know, a big club like Bury, an old club like Bury, can just be expelled, just go under like that?
Yeah, and in the circumstances especially, because normally if a club's just being relegated and it's being under severe pressure, then you can sort of see it. But then when you're aware that these people trying to buy the club and the club's just being promoted and looking forward to a season in League One, that's the bit that just doesn't sit right with me.
Who do you blame for the situation?
I don't think the answers that we all need in order to blame anyone are there for everyone to see yet, but there's definitely been mistakes made. I just find it impossible to think that someone can buy a football club for £1 without showing proof of funds or proof of where they're looking to take the club in the future, and that's a major mistake for me. Especially as players, you expect them governing bodies to be there to protect you.
What would you say to Steve Dale?
I'd say, you've done the unthinkable. You've come into a game not knowing how much it means to people, how much it means to the fans, to the players. Even now, just thinking about it is getting me, because I see them faces every single Saturday. I see the happiness that football brings them, and Steve Dale has to take a serious look at himself and forget football. This is about people's lives, and I honestly don't know the words to say to him, but I'm sure he will feel exactly what he's caused Bury as a town and as a football club.
Can this club rise again, do you think? Is there a future here?
I have no doubt that this town will produce another football team. This is a town that football is their passion. The community loves it. There's some real, real bonds that happen at that ground, and I pray for Bury Town that a phoenix will rise.
Well, as you've been hearing, the demise of the football club is such a big deal to everybody in this town. Let's talk about it in a bit more detail with Tamor Tariq, who's the first deputy leader of Bury Council, Ivan Lewis, MP for Bury South. Thanks for joining us, gentlemen. To you, first of all, Ivan, I've seen reports you're calling on the EFL to reconsider. You say there is a possibility that there is a takeover behind the scenes.
There's definitely a takeover behind the scenes. We've been asked to do two things. Steve Dale to agree a sale of the club, and a consortium which is credible and viable to present the fact that they have sufficient funds to run this football club and pay off some of the debts. We fulfilled those demands today. There's every reason now why the Football League should reconsider their decision and overturn the decision to throw Bury out of the Football League. We've given them every reason within their own rules to do that, and I hope they'll do the right thing.
We all want the club to be saved, of course, Ivan, but people will be asking, why didn't they come forward earlier, and does that make them credible?
To be clear, there was another party negotiating until 3:45 yesterday afternoon exclusively with the English Football League. They withdrew. This consortium had an hour and a quarter, and before 5:00, they expressed their interest to the English Football League, demonstrated that they had the necessary resources available, and got Steve Dale to agree for them to talk to the English Football League. These are serious, viable people. They have met the test that the English Football League has set us time and time again, albeit at the final hour, if you like, the final minute of the final hour. I'm calling upon that, the board of the English Football League today, to do the right thing by these amazing supporters and our town. If we lose Bury Football Club, our town will be massively diminished. Please, English Football League, do the right thing by football, by Bury and by our community.
OK, we'll keep you up to date on that. Tamor, quick word with you. Whatever form the club is in, whether it's a Phoenix club or it's Bury Football Club, which we hope it will be, this ground will be crucial. What can the council do to help the club keep this ground?
So the council is willing to keep open negotiations, as we have been doing with the EFL and with any new potential buyers, and also with the current owner as well. We're very, very clear, and I want to reassure all the fans and everybody connected to the club, this is what we call an asset of community value. Therefore, it's the community that have first dibs on the grounds, and it will not be sold off to any developer or anybody else, as some of the speculation has been in the last couple of days. And that's an absolute reassurance from the local authority. And we will work with, for example, whether it's Forever Bury or any other fan clubs, to preserve this important club, to ensure that we have the grounds here for our local community to benefit from. We have been open to negotiations in recent weeks and days, and today myself and the chief executive have wrote a joint letter to the EFL alongside the communication from Ivan Lewis, Member of Parliament for Bury South, and James Frith, the Member of Parliament for Bury North. We are all working collaboratively on this.
Yeah, absolutely.
The EFL, that we're asking you to reconsider to allow Bury Football Club to have another lifeline to ensure that somebody else...
OK, Tamor, thanks very much indeed. Gentlemen, thank you very much, Tamor. Ivan, thank you very much indeed. We will be back at Gig Lane shortly, but for now, Stuart, back to you.
Thanks, Richard. More of the day's news now, and protests are tip from me, but I'll hand you back to Annabelle, who's at Gig Lane.
Thanks very much, Stuart. Well, as you can see behind me, fans now gathering around their MP, Ivan Lewis, really just hoping that he can offer them any glimmer of hope in this really dire situation for the club. But let's end tonight on a more positive note, if we can. Let's hear from the Richardson family, lifelong Bury supporters, Paul, Helen and Noah, as they have been reflecting on a sad day here at Gig Lane, but also looking forward to the future. From Gig Lane, good night.
My name's Noah. I'm 8 years old. And I went onto the pitch. Players were very friendly. Players let me hold the cup and put the medal on my head.
My name's Helen Richardson, I'm 34 years old and I've been going supporting Bury since I was two. It's a massive part of my life. I grew up on Gig Lane, my family home was on Gig Lane. Me and my dad have been watching Bury for like ever and it's magical times you get to spend with your dad and make friends at the club and with other family members as well.
My name's Paul Richardson. I've been supporting Bury 50 years. Normally I make a holiday out of going to watch Bury. My life's evolved around watching Bury. You know, I've planned my holidays that way. I've been down to Cornwall quite a lot when Bury have been playing either Torquay or Plymouth or Exeter.
I've had sleepless nights, spent a lot of last night crying. You know, it's just, it's really emotional and hopefully we can rise again and come back stronger and in a better position financially.
And I really hope that you come back in a few years. I'll be really, really happy. I'll just be super duper happy and I'll be start watching Bury again.